welcome to the All Real Show. This is where we discuss issues pertaining to the socioeconomic system and how they relate to everything. Why and how are the fundamental questions? Answer them enough, you get to the truth. I'm your host, Alex, and welcome back to part two of my discussion with Tio, the founder and creator of TROM, which is an amazing, amazing project. Really, I can't stress it enough. I know some people that listen to this show already are familiar with it. Some have heard of it. It's if you haven't, you know, that's what this is all about. For me, I say it on the outro, and it really is. And I know it is for you also, Tio, but that's ultimately what this is all about for us and people who do things like this is the message. And you've taken literally years of your life. And you've laid this out, and it's not just the documentary that you've laid out. There's so many resources on there that people can look at. There's books, there's videos, it's amazing. And I will start this again. We'll get into TVP here in just a second, but I do kind of want to go a little bit longer with this TROM. I know, as you said in the end of the last show, that a lot of the books and articles you wrote for TVP magazine and you brought them over to the TROM site. But there's so much more on there. I mean, that's you're the main curator of TROM, right? You haven't really had much help with that, have you?
Yeah. I'm pretty much the main one who does stuff there. But for the past years, let's say 2 years or so, more and more people got involved, so they also right. do their own thing. We have like Seb is making this kind of TROM poems, original stuff that he does, like these videos, short videos, very well made, original stuff. You know, we have people helping with we released a TROM operating system, a customized one, TROM Gyro. There, people also help with some stuff. You know, people who proofread, translate. Aaron, he translates everything in German. This guy is like crazy. He translates everything. Everything we have is in German. Sometimes I'm writing a book and before I finish it, this guy finishes the book in German. I don't know how the
He knows what you're going to say before you say it.
Yeah. He does lots of work, you know.
That's
so there
awesome,
are some
man.
People who are very, very involved and other people who write books, like Dima, who writes books. He also works on another book for TROM now. So yeah, we make a lot of stuff. I mean, well, a bunch of stuff. Maybe it's not a lot, but it's still, it's in terms of the amount of stuff we are like, just to give you an example. So we write books and we don't just write books, but we have to review those books. So it takes a long time. We have to design them. Everything is original. Whatever we write and whatever with the design and everything with everything we make is with open source software. So just to showcase that you can do it. We have almost like a weekly podcast for the past year or so or more. We make a bunch of different kinds of videos. We curate news, curate documentaries, curate applications, curate videos. So it's like a lot. Like if we have a TROM, like I said, operating system, Linux operating system, another like video on it, which is a documentary based website that we curate documentaries and decentralize them. A bunch of other things that I may forget now, but yeah, most of them I'm doing or initiating them, but I also get some help, quite good amount of help sometimes, actually.
Right. I'll cover some of those other things that you may have forgot just now, but real quick, and again, the links will be in the description, but you, you and the team now do a TROMcast pretty much every week on Thursdays. I know it's 8 p.m. Madrid time. I don't know what that amounts to in UTC, but for people, again, the link will be in the description. But to join that, they go to TROM site /live?
Yeah, usually before we start live, we implemented this system on our website that where we put live updates all the time, so we don't rely on Facebook or other just on TROM site. So TROMsite.com/live. Whenever we get close to that hour of streaming, we put some links there that you can even either join us because it's open, anyone can join, or you can just see it on YouTube, you stream it on YouTube.
Right, okay. Yeah, and you guys use Jitsi Meet. This is the first time I'm actually using it, and it's pretty convenient. It's nice, and it's open source, and I know you're big on that. Mm-hmm. I am too, and that's the way of the future, isn't it? I mean,
it's so much stuff. Yeah.
No, go ahead, man. Yeah.
No, I want to say there's so much open source out there in terms of software that people have no idea. Like, for example, now I'm in the process of curating hundreds of apps for tromjaro.com because you have this kind of like app library there. People can install applications from there. And man, it's full of any kind of application that you want to edit videos, create, watch whatever you want to watch, record and so forth. So yeah, for Tromcast, we use this kind of Jitsi Meet. It's interesting because it's like you don't need any application. It just works right in a browser or whatever. It just sends someone a link.
You don't have to sign up or anything.
No. Don't collect the data, nothing like that.
Right. Yeah, you've mentioned TromJaro a couple of times. I definitely want to talk about that. That's very interesting to me. You've actually created an operating system, correct?
Yeah, but let's be honest. I didn't create an operating system. I mostly customized and tweaked another.
I see. Okay.
Because that's how it works with in the world of open source. It's no point to reinvent the wheel all of the time.
Right.
You know? So you take whatever wheel someone invented and make it better, maybe, or in your own way. So we
good
took
way of saying it.
There are many Linux distributions, Linux operating systems, basically. We took just one of them that I tested for a while, and now we customized it, and it's
well. Talk to me because I'm ignorant with this stuff. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know very basic. So for somebody that's listening that doesn't quite understand anything we're saying right now, mm-hmm. Well, Linux is an operating system just like Windows or Mac, correct?
Yeah, in more like honest terms, let's say Linux is the core. It's someone made an analogy, good analogy for like Linux is the engine, okay? But you can take the engine and make all kinds of cars based on the engine. Mm-hmm. You can make motorbikes if you want. You can make big trucks or whatever. So that's the engine,
right.
You know. And we took. You didn't take the engine itself. We took another car that had the engine because it's very difficult to invent the car also, you know. So we took that and we customized it in a way that we have all kinds of unique things about it. We call it trait-free, but we are going to get into that maybe because that's important.
Yes, we are. Yes, very important. Yeah, okay. So yeah, that's and then you've been working. I saw that also somewhere you wrote that, but you guys have been working on a lot of apps for it as well. You're up to how many now?
Yeah, these apps are not that we make, you know. There are apps that are out there made by other people, but we curate them. We test to see if they're what we call a straight free, meaning you don't have to give anything in return for using this application, you know. And sometimes we help them here and there, like people like Roma and past Dave, they try to help fix some bugs here and there with other apps and all kinds of technical stuff, but I'm not that technical in that regard. Mm-hmm. I can mainly report bugs and test software, and I did that for a bunch of such applications, and because of that, others improved them because I report those bugs. That's how the open source works. You know, it's a collaborative way of doing things, which I love.
Exactly. Yes. And so much more proficient and efficient. Mm-hmm. I mean, open source is directly I relate or compared to patents, and you know that's a huge hindrance and negative. I think that again, most people in general don't think about or take into account how patents hinder so much progress. You know, because the way I quickly try to explain it is, you know, it's common sense, but when you think about it, you're like, that's true. You know, say me and you, we're both competing to make a more efficient, you know, doesn't matter, cell phone or anything. Once I come up with it, and as you're saying, you were pointing out, open source, me, you, and the whole world would be like, great, now we've advanced to this point. And then you, since you're working on the same thing, you can start from that point and keep going forward. But what closed source and patents do is once we get to that point as a company, instead of society being to that point, only we are. And even though you're working and resourcing and using, you know, time and energy and resources on the same thing, you're essentially starting from way behind unnecessarily.
Oh, absolutely. And it's even a matter of life and death sometimes, because
exactly.
I'm giving a brief example. Now we are going through this pandemic with coronavirus, and one problem was ventilators. Ventilators are what keep those patients alive, and because of the lack of them, people are dying. Yet they don't open source their schematics for those ventilators so others can do them. Actually, some people wanted to open source them, and then they are getting sued by a company because, you know, it's too close to their patents and so forth. This is complete craziness. Imagine if you could open source such things, because, okay, software is extremely important, but you can also open hardware, which is also extremely important, you know.
Yeah, I know. And the same thing with the ventilators, I saw that, where they were 3D printing, but they had to, again, like we were saying, start from behind because the company wouldn't reveal basically the blueprints. So they didn't know exactly how to 3D print this shit. So they kept trying different things. And, you know, it's literally a race against time for life. But because of the insanity of patents and closed source and control, you know, they could have said, okay, here's the blueprints, 3D print them, you know. Mm-hmm. And great.
And
okay.
Improve on that, you know.
Yeah, and improve on top of that. Right, right.
Yeah.
And let's go ahead and get into the trade free, because I would like to spend a little bit of time on that. I know that's huge. When I actually was speaking with Sasha recently about it, I told her, and I'll tell you same thing and to the audience, I admit if I'm wrong with something. And it's not necessarily that I was wrong per se, but I, like a lot of people, have stayed on the money, you know, which it is the money. Yes. But basically what I'm trying to say is that when you point out and Trom points out that it's trade more than the money. And the glaring explanation of that helped me get it pretty much right away was, you know, people, of course, it's easy to say, well, this costs money, that costs. People get that right away. But then you'll say something like, well, YouTube, well, I don't pay anything for that. Or, you know, Facebook, yeah, I don't pay anything for that. But when you incorporate trade into it, you see, you are actually trading stuff for that. You're trading your personal information and whatnot. So what led you to realize that, I guess? I mean, what made you separate trade from the money aspect?
Yeah, that's, to me, extremely important, because it has to do with my journey, actually, with TVP. And now I won't get into that, but I'll mention that the more that I've read about TVP and the more that I interacted with people there and so forth, I realized that if they focus on money, they kind of come up with solutions like cryptocurrencies or all kinds of tokens. And then I was like, isn't this the same? You know, isn't this the same as money? And then I said to myself, because I was doing TVP magazine and I was taking all kinds of important subjects and discussing about them, I was like, let's discuss about money, because I wrote about money in TROM documentary and so forth, but I want to go deep into that to see what money is. And I wrote a book, The Money Game and Beyond, and that was for me the turning point, because I started to explain money, and like I realized that it's nothing more than just this a representation of trades, and it can be money, it can be shells, and can be Bitcoin, it can be anything else. Today is data or attention economy and so forth, but at the core of it, that's what we do. We give stuff in order to get stuff. You know, that's why people go to work. They don't go to work to get money. I knew that, but I had another different kind of view of it. They just trade their energy and time and skills to get some food and some whatever, healthcare and so forth. And we only represent that with money. And I realized that if we focus on money, we are kind of blind in one eye, because cryptocurrencies are the same. And a kind of cryptocurrencies made me a bit, because it kind of annoyed me to see so many people coming at TVP magazine, be like, hey, dude, you know, we invented this TVP coin or whatever the fuck. I'm like, what the fuck, man?
Right.
It's not about that, you know? So I tried to explain that. And then I realized after writing this book, I went through all kinds of systems, people trying to organize a society with communism and socialism and technocracy and Buckminster Fuller and so forth. The core of our society is just a simple mechanism that we do every day. We just trade. It was mind blowing to me, because before I had this notion of money, you know, money is so bad because banks invent money, and then okay, I know all that. You can go in details and see how money is created, but this is kind of pointless. Is because cryptocurrencies are also a different kind of monster. They also get invented in like weird ways because there are so many of them. So I realized that this doesn't really matter. I wanted to take people's attention from money and put them on trade, especially because today with the internet, the biggest trade is not money. The biggest trade is data. That's what they're trading. And even if people have the argument that yes, they trade data because they want to make money, well, it doesn't matter. The trade there between you and Google is data. They really rely on data and on attention and these kinds of things that have little to do with money. They can invent their own cryptocurrency, like Facebook will invent their own. You will see. They're already working on that. And probably YouTube will invent that and all kinds of tokens and so forth. What about social credits in China? When I was like reading about that, I'm like, wow, this is a new thing. They give social credits, basically. The way that you behave, you get points based on that. And with those points, and with those points, you can get food or whatever, accommodation. So I'm like, if you focus on money, oh, you are going to miss what is going to happen in this world, because money will become less and less important. And then cryptocurrencies, social credits, data, and so forth will become very important. And here's the thing, in the future, you'll see Google has self-driving cars and you will not pay anything, but in terms of money, but you will pay with your data and attention. You know, Google will send you a self-driving car to your home and you go inside there and Google will mine your data and then push ads into your face so that Google can better control you and then sell that data to other people and then gain more whatever power for themselves, you know. But they rely on these things, and money is not that important in the equation. That's what I kind of realized, you know. Money itself is not a problem, but trade, you know, the core of it, it is, because trade, it's what allows. Without trade, money doesn't make any sense, because even in terms of like let's say putting value on something, if you have no trade, is like just a way of ranking, maybe, but it has no property of a currency. You know, a currency has the property of being a currency. If you trade stuff, you know, move stuff from one to another, that will be in a nutshell. But of course, after that, I wrote a massive book over 1,000 pages long called The Origin of Most Problems, looking in detail on this subject, exactly the subject of trade. In from data trade to influencers, what you may call today, to all kinds of trades that have nothing or less to do with money, don't even involve money in the process, you know. That's why I think the focus should be on trade and not on money, just for the sake of not missing out on these other trades that are so and so popular today.
Yes, very well said, Tio. The origin of most problems you just mentioned is the defining book, basically. It kind of highlights it as immediately and briefly as possible. Like you said, it is all about that, the trade aspect that you're mentioning. I highly encourage people to read it, because it will start to, if not fully, shift your ideas and perceptions about what we're saying. And I like the saying you use, blind in one eye. That's a good way to put it, because, you know, again, it's not about right and wrong. You know, some things can be, but most things, to me, it's not about that. You know, okay, even if you're right, it's not like you're better or this. It's just like, hey, okay, that's great, because now we're all on more of the same or the right path, you know, in understanding or whatever. And I like that, blind in one eye, because you can be fully aware of the money problem. And like I said, it's just trade. It kind of, that's a good way to say it. It opens the other eye. It adds the extra element that's kind of missing. And I'll say that real quick, too, about the cryptocurrency thing. I honestly thought that shit almost immediately. I'm like, but it's the same thing. I mean, then you, okay, it's decentralized and whatnot, but then you still need it to survive, right? So if I don't have cryptocurrency, even though there's way more than enough food, you're telling me I'm going to starve to death. So, yeah, that immediately to me didn't make much sense. So the trade is, you know, they say money is the root problem, and it is. But I just thought this when you were talking, that another analogy is to, like, say money is the root problem, but trade is the flower pot that it sits in. You know, it is kind of the all-encompassing thing. You know, kind of like I was saying earlier about how things influence you over time, like you just said. So you actually came to that conclusion by working with TVP and experiencing that, right? And how people were thinking about it and approaching it.
People have also this, I've realized over the years, have a weird way of making simple things look complicated and complicated things too simple. So I'm like, in the end, you know, what are we doing in this society? I understood it before with money, but then I had a much clearer picture. I was like, the only thing that we do is, like, we are rats who just, we have enough for everybody. This is another thing that I realized, because TVP focuses a lot on scarcity. And I agree. I wrote about that. I explained that. And I talked to them a lot about that. Like, they say scarcity creates the need for trade, and then creates the need for money and so forth. If we had an abundance, like Jack said, of, I don't know, trees making apple trees and so forth, no one will trade for them or give money, because everybody will have access to. What I also realized with the Money Game and Beyond book is that we have an abundance of pretty much everything in this world. And I know it's someone from TVP one time, Tromcast, we had this kind of debate about scarcity and trade. And I asked this guy, like, can you give me one example of scarcity, a real scarcity, technological scarcity that we have in the world? And he couldn't find one. Of course, we have some, like organ for transplant. But else, food is more than enough. You know, housing and clothes and even medical treatments, most of them, from pills to so forth, it's abundant. So I realized that, okay, focusing on scarcity may not allow you to explain in good ways this world that we live in. So in my way, I said, look, we have an abundance of stuff there, but in order to get it, we have to trade for it. If I want a Ferrari now, probably I would have it, even in this fucking pandemic now. I think if I have enough money, it's a Ferrari somewhere close to me and I can buy it. You know, it's not that much of a scarcity in that sense. You know, there is stuff there all the time. It's just that I have to trade for it. And all I'm saying is, we shouldn't create a society that we have now that's abundant already in terms of stuff. We shouldn't create that based on trade. Trade is unnecessary. We have more than enough to give people a straight free, like nothing in return, all of this stuff that we have around. You know, we can start slowly here and there with the needs and so forth, but it's possible. You know, that's my way of thinking. And it's easier in my view to explain it with trade, because people focusing on money, they focus so much on this kind of Federal Reserve Bank and then the US dollar and the euro and the taxes, and it's like, I try to explain with this economy, to me is almost like it's the economy is all just trade, basically. It's a trade based system, but it's almost like, you know, pizza. We think pizza is this kind of like pizza, you know, Italian pizza, whatever you put names of it. But in truth, because I make pizza at home. I know to make pizza at home now. And in truth, it's just, it's bread. It's bread with some fucking things. It's just like a fucking sandwich, okay?
That's right.
We call it a pizza. And I think that's what we do with the economy. We call it an economy. We make it complicated. We put names on it. But in truth, it's just fucking trade. That's what we do. You know, the fact that we make it complicated doesn't make it different. You know?
Right.
So I wanted to make it this simple thing that we do be simple and have a simple definition. No, don't complicate this thing. Economy does, it's a pizza, you know, but in truth, it's a sandwich kind of. It's kind of like that.
Exactly, Tio. Yeah. I feel the same way with just staying along the same lines of economy and different things. You know, I don't watch them, but I've seen all kinds of, you know, people in their business suits or whatever, and not even, I mean, even real intellectual people, you know, like Noam Chomsky or, you know, all these different Chris Hedges, even these different people where they're sitting there and they might be doing it just for the sake of, but they're explaining capitalism and, like you said, all in detail and this and that and blah, blah. And I'm like, okay, well, really all it is, these several handful of motherfuckers said, hey, guess what? We own everything and you all have to give us something, trade. You have to trade us something in return to have it. I mean, and I said that very short and simplistic, but yeah, I know what you mean. Most things are that people make them more complicated or are less complicated than they need to be, whatever. But yeah, most things are very easy to understand. That's the point I'm trying to make. They really are. I mean, it's just a matter of, okay, what is it? Why and how? Those are the two questions, you know, why something is the way that it is. And typically it's not that hard to figure out the reality.
And we should start to ask also, I know the saying is ask maybe better questions, whatever. I think we should ask more simple questions about our society. Like, what is it that we want? What do we want in this society? Like, what do you want from people? You know, if some aliens will come here and be like, what are you guys doing? And I can only explain to them that, well, you know, every morning I have to wake up, go do some stuff in order to stay in this apartment. Else I will not be able to stay, despite being an abundance of apartments out there. So most of people, that's what they do, which is a bit of a crazy, more than a bit. It's a crazy situation to be in. And we shouldn't make it complicated, you know, because it's complicated when you look at, of course, even Italians will talk about pizza in very complicated ways. They have all kinds of names. And I'm like, shut the fuck up. You know, you just put four types of cheese on the fucking, like,
yeah, right,
dough that is like a bread dough. Like, shut up. I make you go home now. It's fine. It's, I know the secrets. So it's not that complicated, the economy. It's only complicated when people make it complicated. Right. In truth, we don't do more in this world than just move stuff around, move stuff and people around from one place to another, you know?
Yeah. Well, you know, Tio, what you were just saying too, man, I've done that before with people. You talking about the pizza made me think that basically the more shit you say about something, the more intricate and detailed it sounds. You know, if you say, I ate a hamburger last night and fries. You're like, oh, okay. But I could say it totally different. I could say, yeah, I ate a well-sautéed beef patty with seasoning, you know, onions, tomatoes, thin sliced. You know, you're like, wow, this sounds really good. But it's really just a fucking hamburger and fries, exactly. You know? Yeah, it's kind of silly. I mean.
Yeah, and that's what they do with the economy. That's what I try to. Like with the origin of most problems, for example, to explain a simple way, like how this works. Because I don't like people who, they make it even, I don't know, sometimes maybe Peter Joseph also does this a bit more complicated, but still great. I mean, he does a great job. But others, like, just don't complicate it. Just don't complicate, because it's not that complicated what we do here, you know. And people may get lost and may think that hamburger or whatever sandwich is something different. Oh, it's a Mac whatever Royale.
Right.
It's not. It's just a fucking sandwich and that's it. You know, you have to deal with that.
Yes. Peter Joseph is very intellectual, and that's the way he talks and comes across. And I totally agree with what you're saying. This is, again, the point that I make a lot, kind of like I mentioned earlier about we all play a part. We all play a role. And, you know, I may reach people that you won't. You may reach
absolutely,
people
yeah.
that I won't. You know, and same with that, right? Peter Joseph is going to reach people that maybe you and I won't. And same, you know.
Yeah, I agree.
So, yeah, you know, and that's why I do think it's important, or, you know, ideally for everybody who is smart enough and knowledgeable enough and cares enough to do what they can, you know, because I think everybody plays a role, everybody has an impact.
No, for sure, yeah.
Yeah.
No, I agree.
And we'll go ahead and finish up with TVP here. I mean, we've hinted on it the whole time, but I would like to know a little of your personal experience with them. I mean, you've already said some stuff, but I think, like I said in the Sasha show, you know, I'm all for TVP. I am. Their idea is perfect. Like it's right. It's on point. You know, it's what the future is, like I tell people, it's basically what the future is going to look like, because it's the most logical, efficient, you know, all that way. But I think it's very, very important and vital for people to kind of, you know behind the scenes stuff that they won't know otherwise unless they hear it from somebody like you that's gone through it. Mm-hmm. And I'd just like to ask you, I mean, if you kind of want to touch on Start Again, how you started working with them, but also like your experience with them overall.
Yeah, for sure. So I think I think it's fair for me to divide TVP in two. So for me, TVP is TVP, the idea behind what you see on their websites and so forth, like Jack's work, and TVP, the organization. So I think TVP, the idea, it's a great inspirational idea. It's really, really great. I'm still showcasing it maybe to people. It's like, look, as an example, of course, right. It lacks a lot of details. Like I was telling Roxanne about that so many times, but I don't think it's meant to be taken literally from what I understood from Jack. It's just how the society could look like if we are smart enough to apply science and technology. Now, of course, I cannot say a lot more about that since I've already said in documentaries and so forth. But what I will say is that about the idea of TVP, that I kind of shifted the way that I think about Jack's ideas in terms of I think they want to present how the world works, but I felt like Jack was always presenting that in association with the problem. He was always saying the monetary system is such a big problem, and then I made something here, look here how it will look like if we get rid of this problem. So for me, always the important part was the problem, like Jack focusing on the problem, because it doesn't have to look like the Venus Project. Even Jack was saying these cities will not, if they look like I drew them, then that's a big problem, because it means nothing changed, you know. So things evolve. My only problem here is like people around TVP and so forth focus too much maybe on the idea, and I never kind of agree with that, because they don't know exactly what this TVP is going to be, or I don't know. It's a big, huge subject that maybe we'll make a TROM cast actually about it, because it's a lot to talk about it. But
I agree.
Anyways, I agree. It's a beautiful and interesting, very interesting idea. But the organization, TVP, the organization, was a bit of a surprise for me, because as humans, we project, of course. If we didn't project, we wouldn't go out, because we don't know if we were going to get run by a car or a lion will jump on us. We always project. We think we know that tomorrow we go out and there is be no lions, you know. So in the sense, I projected about TVP some things, and then the organization. And then when I started to work with them, it was a bit different. I realized from my perspective that they were a lot, I don't know, maybe disorganized, extremely disorganized, despite them having lots of teams, you know, a team for this, a team for that, a team. I never was part of any team because I was doing stuff. I didn't have time to spend like chatting on Skype because they were organizing on Skype or whatever. I never had the time to do this. I was writing stuff and creating stuff. So for me, that was the big thing, that they being so disorganized, that's what I felt like. For whatever, they couldn't even make a video unless they were making a team and then creating a logo for the team and then talking.
So they were basically kind of like you were saying earlier, they were making too much out of it, right? Trying to make it too grand.
And to organize this kind of like listing and list and tier and Google Docs and then ideas, I'm like, just do it. Start to do it, you know? And I lost a lot of time with these kinds of things that I shouldn't. People dragging me in this kind of group and that kind of group. I also, so this organization, I think that's the first thing that kind of made me realize that, oh, okay, these people, they are quite disorganized. They don't know how to organize anything here probably. And that's why they don't produce much stuff, I feel like, you know, because I try to produce stuff and it only work when I produce stuff, you know, without going to these hoops and loops and doing like acrobatic things to just make the right of thing there.
Right.
So this organization, that's the first thing that I realized. There are also a bunch of things like they are very protective of their stuff, whatever that is, you know. I used to make websites for them, and Roxanne wouldn't even send me their 3D modelings, the new ones, to me to put on the website when I was making their own website, because she was concerned. I'm like, come on, I'm helping you for the past few years. I mean, you can send them to me. How can I make a website if you don't send me the materials?
Just guess.
You know, it was too much for me. They made me sign a non-disclosure agreement. I mean, that's not something that you may project when you just hear about TVP from YouTube, let's say. You think TVP is this, like, I don't give a fuck about patterns and this and that. And I understand that they have to survive in this society. I understand that. But it felt to me that they are too aggressive with such things. Like, just too aggressive. Like, it makes little sense. Jack says all the time, like, oh, laws and rules and documents and so forth make no difference, you know. The difference makes the environment. Yet they make me want me to sign a non-disclosure, you know. Do you think that I'm going to respect that non-disclosure or something? Like, I don't know. Do you rely on papers like that? I signed in to, like, give them that, whatever. Mm-hmm. But I didn't like that about it. It's so protective.
Right. It was extremely rigid and structured and controlled and opposite of what you were expecting, right?
You know, I think the best that I could define TVP is, like, they want to run TVP as a company, but based on volunteers, in a way. Right, that's what they want to do. And they fail many times, as far as I've seen, because they demand a lot from people and put them through so many lists and whatever groups that they kind of lose them. And I know lots of people from TVP who just got sick of TVP and then just gave up because TVP is too company-ish in that sense, you know. Sign this, sign that, don't talk about this, talk about, I mean, whatever. They should do whatever they want, but I'm saying that's my experience with them.
Yes.
And even Roxanne asked me one point to put, you know, watermarks on TROM documentary for TVP, and I said, look, I never put on anything, like, because it's a free documentary. I don't make anything out of it, so I'm not going to put any watermarks for TVP, because that means I should put for everything that I took from online.
Right.
I put the sources there for everything, though, so. So yeah, these two things are, for me, the biggest is the fact that they seemed very disorganized. Like, they just spend so much time when I was there making teams and lists, but not doing much at all. And then also they are so protective about their stuff to the point of being ridiculous in my view. Like, I've seen people talking, and Roxanne and so forth, sending lawyers after people who put their stuff online. And I said to Roxanne, look, this is not going to work because you want to approach it like today's society with laws and with force. And I said to Roxanne, if you want people to not pirate your stuff, let me showcase you how you can put them your stuff on your website and make like a subscription that's very low, like $3 a month. And you offer people streaming of your content and so forth.
Right.
You know, make it available. That's how I summarize a bit. Probably there are lots of other things.
Yeah, of course. Well, I know on Sasha's web blog, at least, she put yours, hers, and about four or five other people who worked with the Venus Project, their kind of resignation letters, and you know, just again showing the truth of the matter, you know, and trying to expose that truth for what it is. And it's disappointing. I mean, so your main thing that you did for them and with them was you researched and wrote articles for what used to be the TVP magazine, correct?
Yeah. I was designing it. I was doing everything for it. And I got this, like, several times Roxanne was telling me, suggesting me more and more, like, to put quotes of Jack in the magazine. And I was like, I felt a bit like, what is this? No, let's not make a cult here, you know, out of Jack. I want to explain some stuff, you know, forget about, don't focus on Jack. You know, I didn't like these kinds of things. She didn't force me, but she was suggesting it more and more. Oh, put this coat of Jack here or there. I didn't like that. So I managed TVP magazine, but so in a way, look, me and Roxanne, we got along quite well. Like, she's a nice person. I felt that she's very overwhelmed. Like, people message her so many times, emails and so forth. And I understand, me also managing Strom, I get overwhelmed, people coming at me with all kinds of ideas. It's just too much. If you're not in that situation, don't understand. Even three people who come at you in a week with all kinds of ideas, it's just too much. You cannot focus. So I felt sorry for Xand having to deal with such things. I tried to take the work off of her, and I managed their social networks. I was one of the admins for several years, and maybe the only one on Instagram or whatever for several months and so forth. I helped with many other things like that because they're very disorganized. Like I said, that was what I observed, you know, there. And I told that to them. Here's the thing, such things I don't just tell them about behind their backs. I told Roxanne all the time. I was honest with them. Look, you are disorganized. Mm-hmm. I think you are very strict with your materials and stuff like that. So I tried to change them, but my biggest disappointment was that I felt like TVP doesn't change. They don't change. It's the information that it is there is Jack's words, and that's it.
Right.
And as a simple example, when I used to defend TVP a lot on social networks and so forth. Maybe that's not the right word, but to just explain what TVP is all about and people who commented negatively. And one thing was about communism. People many times say, but TVP is like communism and this and that. And TVP's classic answer is like, no, TVP, communism never used money, never whatever. But if you look at the definition of communism and what they try to do, communism didn't want to use money per se. So it's only the implementation of communism in different tribes that was implemented so poorly that had nothing to do with communism, the original ideas. So when I wrote the original Most Problems book, it was a TVP magazine, I corrected that in my mind, and I corrected that on paper to say. And I tried to say to Roxanne and to others, look, let's also change the website and don't say that, communism never used money. Make it more detailed and say, the original ideas of communism, you know, were a bit similar here and there, but this is why TVP is different, and the implementation of communism and blah, blah, blah. Well, even that little thing, they didn't change, they ignored me completely, and I was trying to, like, change a little bit of their website, and I realized that they don't want to change, they don't like to change. You know, that was one of the examples, of course. Mm-hmm. So it was a bit disappointing, because to me, Jack was always someone, I felt like it was someone who says, like, hey, you correct me if I'm wrong, and I will change my mind. But I'm not sure that TVP, the organization, it's on the same path, maybe.
Right. Yeah, again, well said, Tio. That's what I've gathered from speaking with Sasha, reading the different things and kind of getting into it. And it seems like you're saying the same, that that I've learned other places, that I think a big issue is that basically Roxanne wants everything essentially to go through her, right? You know, and so, like you were saying, I mean, anybody with common sense knows that, hell, it's got to be overwhelming to have not only random people sending, you know, ideas and whatnot, and I want to help, and I'm sure they have different people to handle different aspects, but essentially anything that amounts to a change or an alteration or this or that, to have to go through Roxanne, I mean, not only would it be overwhelming for her, but
inefficient and
exactly, very inefficient. And, you know, again, if we're talking somebody's personal blog and you have five people working on it, that's one thing. But when you're talking about essentially somewhat worldwide organization that is proposing to change the world, it's a little different. You know, you have to be realistic and know that you have to put people that you trust that are smart or competent, you know, in charge of things and let them run it, you know? I don't get into really sports that much, a whole lot, but there was a football team years ago that was having that problems, and the owner kept wanting to come and, like, tell everybody what to do, the head coach and everything, and the head coach ended up quitting because he was like, you know, you put me in charge of the team, but here you come, keep trying to tell shit, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think it's important, I want to mention, to talk about a bit about why I think they kind of fail and in organizing stuff from what I've seen. For one is because, like you said, they try to put everything to Roxanne, and that's just not how it cannot work. It doesn't matter who Roxanne is,
it's unrealistic.
It's not going to work.
Right.
If you look at open source projects, you have to learn a bit about that. That's not how they work. That you don't just go to one human being. No, there are all kinds of decisions made by all kinds of people. So if Roxanne wants to, for example, get a hold of, let's say, every social network that are representing TVP, like the TVP Russian, the TVP Spanish team, then she will not be able to, for one, do a good job, and second, they will stop people from getting involved. So there is no way. But second, I think this is a very important point that many people may not realize, is I think it's a problem with what TVP wants. Because if you look at open source, what do you want from open source is for the code to be open. It's quite simple. You know, there are many licenses, it's true. But that's quite a simple movement, if you look at it globally as a movement. Well, if you ask TVP what they want, because here's an important point, open source is not actually open source. It's they are called open source, but it's a bit misleading. They are non-proprietary. They want to solve a problem, but the problem is proprietary software, okay? So they just name it open source, but they have a problem there, proprietary software, and they try to solve it. And you'll see lots of projects with lots of people doing lots of things. Well, what about TVP? If TVP wanted to solve a problem, if they would focus on the problem, then they would let other people come up with solutions. So that's why I switched to trade. Because I'm like, if people want to go get involved with TROM, you don't have to get involved with TROM. If you understand that trade creates most of the problems, I mean, you tackle it in your own way. You make trade free goods and services. You talk about it. You don't have to go through me. That's a different kind of approach. But TVP wants this kind of world that they envision. They focus so much on the solution part that if Roxanne doesn't control it, because I also understand this part, it will get very diluted into all kinds of ideas. And that's going to be normal. If TVP won't focus on the problem, then TVP won't be able to let loose of their idea, you know, because as soon as they let it loose, I've seen that with my own experience with TVP, people interpret it in so many ways that I understand that they want to be, you know, very protective of that, you see. Mm-hmm. But if TVP, and that's my last thing I will say, maybe about this, but if TVP will say, look, guys, money is the problem of trade, okay? And we have this project called the resource-based economy as a solution to trade. Then TVP will be like, if anyone wants to help, you can help with talking about the problem and creating your own kind of trade-free whatever ideas about the future and so forth. You don't have, TVP is just one of the solutions out there, but they don't see it like that. They see it as the solution, you know? So I think that's why they fail, kind of, I would say.
Yes. That's the conclusion that I came to. Pretty much everything you just said. I mean, it, you know, for what you're trying to do, again, if you're trying to, I don't know, start a business or be a corporation, or I mean, yeah, I don't know. Maybe you can have a hierarchical structure or something, you know, but what they're trying to do especially, I think, is they're going about it the total wrong way. I mean, essentially, you can compare it to a religion. I mean, that's what I was listening to you talk, and you know, that's what kept coming back into my head. Like, I mean, it's kind of like a religion, right? You're like, no, this is it. This is the answer. Here, we wrote the book, and that's the fact. That's, you know.
That's how it felt to me in a sense. And I still think that, you know, they have lots of great ideas behind them. There are some great people there doing a lot of work, like Ray, who is in charge of the maybe linguistic team. He's doing subtitling and transcriptions and so forth. But I talk about this in the origin of most problems. If you look at, and it's very relevant for today because of this, again, pandemic, we are now in a pandemic with the coronavirus. Back in the days, microbes killed billions of people, okay? What is the solution to microbes and to little organisms that we call, some we call bacteria, some we call viruses? What is the solution? There is no solution. There are many solutions. But how do we come about as a society to deal with this problem? Well, by focusing on the problem. And if you focus on the problem, you will come up with many, many solutions. That's how TVP should be. Or whatever. They should be whatever they want. But I think that that's how TROM is going to... That's what TROM tries to project. To project focus on the problem. And then people will come up with ideas. Cancer will be solved, this problem of cancer, only because people will focus on the problem called cancer. The more you focus on it, the more solutions will come up with. It's no one solution for anything. Just keep this in mind, Alex. Open source, when these people tried to invent this kind of non-proprietary movement, they didn't envision a society or how an open source society would look like and project about the future. No. They started to say proprietary software is a problem, and then we have some solutions. You know, that's how they approach it. And then they penetrate the society, to put it like that, you know, here and there, and do some changes. But TVP kind of, in my view, wants this top-down, in a way, approach, even though Jack said that it's not top-down or bottom-up, but it feels like TVP is like, we have this grand solution of how the society should look like. And I don't think that anymore. I don't think that should be, that is the, will be the case how the society will change. I think society will change in small steps through education, through infrastructure. I don't think we will ever going to transition into a society like make a new city and then make another one and stuff. I just don't think that.
Yeah, that's actually another interesting point that, you know, again, my experience of, you know, interacting with people that affiliate with TVP or, you know, like them or like follow them or whatever, it seems to be that's a big a general thing that people will say, you know, we need to build a city or a town, or we need to start, you know, let's go start and find a ghost town and people will follow us and the world will love. You know, I mean, you know, anything, I guess, technically is possible, but I think it's unrealistic to think that that's going to happen because, you know, there's been, even today, there's some societies that are, you know, trade free and co-ops and, you know, they do their own thing. They grow their own food and shit. Well, you don't see the world jumping on the bandwagon and changing, you know? And of course we can go on and on about, well, there's still a lot of most of those, even if they're like that, they're still influenced by society, you know?
Oh, absolutely. And society is complicated, you see. It's right. Not like you can build a city, which is a huge undertaking. Let's be honest. I mean, and some people from TVP get a bit upset on me when I say this, but TVP blew up $200,000 on a script for a movie, you know? So they didn't make the script still, like 10 years later. Even Roxanne asked me to make the script at one point. I made the script. They liked it, but not enough. For free, I made it, of course. But they failed on that. I don't think TVP is going to build any city anytime soon.
Yeah, that's an important point also that, we brought up when I talked with Sasha. And it's on TVP's website. I mean, they tell you that, you know, we got $200,000 donated and they're going to use it for this. And essentially, I read it. Honestly, I started skimming it because it's long and drawn out. And it seems like they were talking in circles. But yeah, basically, that's what they were saying, was coming up with reasons why it hasn't happened. And, you know, well, we're working on this and we're getting closer to that and we'll keep you posted. And, you know.
Yeah, it's unfortunate it didn't happen. Of course, I would like. I wish for them to do that, but I'm just saying, like, seeing them how disorganized were when I was there, from my perspective at least, and then seeing them blowing $200,000 on a movie script and they couldn't even make that, then I'm extremely doubtful that they are going to build any city. And for that matter, for anyone, even if Musk will say that he will build a city that's whatever, trade here or whatever, I still think it takes a lot more to change. The society is big, you know? It's like India, it's China, it's those people, like half of the population, for fuck's sakes, almost, like, whatever, like billions of people there, billions of people in America. I think the only way to change society is more in this incremental way. Yes, it would be great to have this kind of, if you can make a prototype of a city to prove how we can do it, maybe no jobs and maybe automation and so forth. But don't think that that's the solution, because I just doubt, you know, that that's the way to go.
Yeah. Yeah, it's, I mean, I am with you ultimately, but like, you know, you're saying, it is hard to say, you know, what, I think in general, most people, they want that, what's the term, the magic bullet, or not the magic bullet. Yeah, the silver bullet. There you go. You know, yeah, they want that one solution. And again, I've seen this a lot, Tio, where in different discussions and forums or whatever, where several people will say that, you know, on, say, Zeitgeist or anything, they'll say, yeah, you guys have been talking about this. What are you doing? You know, where's the change? And it's like, well, I mean, I want that more than the person saying it, believe me. But it's kind of like you were saying earlier about how can you measure that? I mean, the fact that if you go even, you know, 10 years back, how many people weren't aware of Zeitgeist and Venus Project and TROM and different things, that now those people are awake and they're advanced and they might be coming up with ideas and thoughts. That's huge progress, but you can't physically see that, you know?
It's also, for me, ultimately, it boils down to, what is it that you want, guys? Because for me, I want to solve a problem. I want to, the same way that people want to solve cancer, I want to solve this problem of trade. Because wherever I see trade, I see, like, okay, it's a problem. Then people behave badly. And that's why I try to simplify it and be like, let's make it a bit simple. Because if people are just aware of TVP and then TZM and then think about RB and cities and automation. I think it's so all over the place. It's relevant. Mm-hmm. It's good. I'm not saying that. I'm not arguing with that. Okay. Right. But I feel it's all over the place and people don't know what to do. And I've seen that so many times. People don't know what to do. They're like,
that's true.
Well, maybe I should build an RB society. Maybe. And then I'm asking them, what do you try to solve here? What is your struggle about? You know, because if we keep it simple and say, look, like the open source are doing, the open source are saying proprietary software is bad, is very bad. If we are doing the same with trade, that's what I'm trying to do with a new documentary to explain this in detail. If we are saying, look, wherever we see trade, it's a problem. So we have to make trade obsolete. Keep it simple because it's still relevant. We also talk about money, you talk to cryptocurrencies and all of that. You know, vegetables and fruits in the salad, whatever. We talk all of that in the pizza, whatever. We talk about all of that. Keep it simple, and then people may come up with ideas. Because imagine this, for example, we made this TROM Jaro, the Linux distribution, okay? Why I did that? It's not like people are lacking Linux distributions now. No, it's a fucking shit ton of them out there. Right. But I made it to label DMMS trade free to give people a clue like, hey, look, open source is good, but open source and trade free, it's a lot better because you can have an open source application that also collects your data. It's just that it's open source. It's not going to make that much of a difference. Or they can put ads into your face or sell subscriptions. And what we say is like, look, we promote software that wants nothing from you. It's the purest form of charity in that sense. So we use this thing like TROM Jaro. We not only do a good thing because it's an operating system people can use and many people use it, but we also project an educational way of just education, project education through that, you know. So imagine this. Imagine you make trade-free goods and services. For one, you make good goods and services, like quality and goods and services, and you help people with that. And second, you also educate people about it. That's what open source does. And I think I got a lot of inspiration from open source because it kind of works, you know, to do something at least, to move things on the ground. And that's what I'm trying to do with whatever projects we make now, to label them as trade free and say, look, this is trade free. And we have a link there and you go to tradefree.org, which is another website that I built, and explain there, like, what do we mean by trade free? You know, it's almost like an open source kind of approach. And let's see where it goes. You know, TVP can go with their own things and TZM and so forth. I would like for them to also pay attention to this thing because I paid attention to whatever they're saying a lot. I wish for them to also pay attention to this way of thinking. You know, maybe they will find some valuable stuff in it.
I agree with you, T.O., and I do think it's vital, the point you're trying to stress, that to have the right sense of direction. I mean, one way I can kind of relate that is I've said for a while, you know, take all these protests you see all over the world for different things. It doesn't matter if it's climate change, gay rights, voting, you know, more minimum wage. Well, if you take them all, and to me, they're all pretty much 99.9%, they're misdirected energy because, like you were saying, you're not really going after the root problem and the core problem. So, you know, hypothetically, say you're marching for in the United States, some people are saying $15 minimum wage. Okay, you get that passed. Then what? Do you pat yourself on the back and say we accomplished something? But nothing really changed, you know? And I just think that that's very important, the point you were trying to make of people having a clear direction and understanding the real problem. And that's why I think, and we'll go into that now more, that the trade free, but why for me that was, I caught it. You know, and it opened my second eye, like you said, because I, you know, I'm very understanding and knowledgeable. I get why things happen and how they have those types of things. And it's not to say that that's necessarily wrong or even the wrong direction totally. But when I started thinking about the trade, like I said, it totally, almost like the flower pot, it encompassed, it enclosed the roots. It, you know, it filled in everything, even stuff, like I said, where most people would say, well, Facebook, YouTube, you know, those things, they don't charge you. Well, no, they actually do. you're trading for them. And that's why I think that's a good example to use for people that immediately puts it in your face like, oh, shit. Well, yeah, that's true. I'm trading for that.
It's an easy way to a bit unpack this world, you know, especially with the online stuff that's happening all the time. I even made like a shirt, like worked for it is called. In the book, I put like weight is if you unwrap that, weight is means like, what am I trading? So I was like, you should always wait. Like, what am I trading? Every time you encounter a service there, what am I trading here? You know, because then you may think differently. Like, what am I trading to Google, to Facebook, to this app, to whatever governments, you know? It's an easier way, I'll say, that gives you direction.
Yeah, well said, Tio. And I like that acronym a lot. Wait, what am I trading? That's a good one to keep in mind, people. With this show, you're trading some time for stimulating, thought-provoking, insightful knowledge and discussion. And I really want to thank you all for doing so. I hope you enjoyed it, and I really hope you got something out of it. That's what this is all about for me, trying to inform, educate, and inspire people. The sooner people realize the veil of lies we bought into, and that we already possess all the knowledge, resources, and technology we need for sustainability and abundance for everyone, the sooner the transition can start. Please feel free to email, follow, share, comment, like, subscribe. I welcome any and all feedback or support. And I hope you'll tune in next time for another episode of the All Real Show. We are